Good morning, everyone. My name is Loi, and I'm CEO and co-founder of Kyber. So super excited to be here in the Changelog stage to give the update on the growth of Kyber in the last few months. But first of all, I know that many of you are new here, so I'm going to give a quick introduction about what Kyber is, and what are the use cases that we have been building together with the entire ecosystem. So the main and only focus of Kyber so far is to power the instant and secure decentralized token exchange, right, in any decentralized applications. So what I mean by that is that we want to allow either end users, decentralized application, wallets, website, to do decentralized trading, right, like everywhere. And the way we do it is that we built a protocol to aggregate all the liquidity sources from different partners, from different projects, and we obtain the best rate from all of them and make it available in one single interface for any of these application wallets and websites to take it, right? So they only need to talk to Kyber to get the best rate available in the market. So what are the main use cases? First of all, end user token trading, right? The users, they can easily trade or swap from one token to a different one, right? And in a decentralized and secure manner. That means they don't have to trust anyone. They don't have to rely on a custody or any other third party. The second use case is decentralized payments. As in, if you have some token A and you want to purchase some item, but the merchants only have token B, right? So you can pay with Kyber. We will do the conversion on the fly, and the merchant will still receive the payment in token B. And one of the use cases that we have been pushing very hard in the Ethereum ecosystem is providing liquidity for all the DeFi applications. I'm going to talk about this later. But the main use cases that we have been working with includes margin trading, loans, investment, as in asset management, right, and many other arbitrage programs as well. So this is one of the examples in which we allow an interesting value flow between different DeFi applications. So take Fulcrum as an example. They allow people to borrow the asset, right? Like if the users has Ether and they want to borrow DAI. So the users can collateralize the Ether with Fulcrum, and Fulcrum will give them DAI. Of course, the user will have to pay the interest. So now if the price of Ether drops, and Fulcrum will have to liquidate the Ether to get back the principal amount of DAI, right? They will do that instantly on Kyber, because Kyber is already linked with many other liquidity providers to handle the swapping, right? So Fulcrum doesn't have to trust Kyber because everything is on the smart contract. The users doesn't have to trust Fulcrum because they can easily verify everything on the blockchain as well. So this will create a chain of value exchange between different platforms, different parties. But the nice thing about this is that no one has to trust anyone, right? That's the best thing about DeFi and connecting all the different parties using blockchain and smart contract. Okay, so what makes Kyber unique, right? Like what are the properties that we offer that other people cannot, right? The first thing is that we are able to create one aggregated liquidity pool, and we make it super easy for any taker, be it end users, be it website, wallet, DeFi application, to integrate with Kyber and take the liquidity that we already and take the liquidity from the pool that we already created. And secondly, we make it super flexible for anyone to contribute liquidity to this pool, right? The market makers, they can use either automated market making solution like Uniswap. They can use a very complicated strategy that they have been using for central exchanges to contribute liquidity to Kyber. So it makes it very easy for anyone to contribute liquidity to this pool. And what's more interesting is that, and very important is that everything is fully on-chain. As in, everything will run and power by the smart contract. This makes it very easy to integrate. So people have been talking about the financial Lego, right? Like, you know, if you run everything on the smart contract, it's very easy for you to plug, to connect with other smart contract. It's as easy as, you know, you plug in different Lego pieces to build something new, right? And everything transparent. You don't have to introduce a new trust model or break your existing trust model, because the only thing that you have to trust here is the blockchain, right? Which you already trust in the first place. Now, let's talk about the numbers. How we have been doing and growing our ecosystem, our network in the last, I think, 6 or 7 months. The first thing is the trade volume. Since the beginning of the year, we have been seeing the consistent growth. This is the monthly volume, right? In terms of Ether, we saw a 6x growth in terms of trade volume month by month, right? And in terms of fiat, it's even higher. It's 12x, thanks to the higher appreciation of crypto asset in the last few months. And we keep breaking the monthly trading record month by month. And we expect to see the same growth in the coming months. So where is this volume coming from, right? So wallets like MyEther Wallet, Trust Wallet from Binance, and also Kyber, we also have Kyber Swap, contributes 45% of the volume, right? And this is according to the last month volume in August. And what we saw, what is also interesting is the DeFi applications that integrated with Kyber, they also contribute up to 40% of the volume. So this is very much different from what we saw 4 or 5 months ago, in which they barely contribute any volume to Kyber, right? And of course, there are many other applications that integrated with Kyber, but we are not aware of, because it's totally open and transparent and permissionless to integrate with Kyber. We have been consistently ranked first or second in terms of top volume in all the decentralized trading platforms in Ethereum. And these are all the partners that we know that have integrated with Kyber. I'm sure that we miss many of them because they don't inform us when they integrate with Kyber. But we expect to see this picture to get more crowded in the coming months. So let's go through a few major integration. In terms of wallet, we have MyEther Wallet Engine, the one that got integrated with Samsung Galaxy S10. We also have Trust Wallet from Binance. And they actually contribute a lot of volume and consistently, right? We also see that other DeFi applications like Nuo and Fulcrum, they are one of the majors that contribute the volume to the network. And of course, Kyber Swap is a best user-friendly DEX that Kyber built. And I'm going to talk about Kyber Swap in more details now. So what makes Kyber Swap different, right? So first of all, apart from allowing fully on-chain and decentralized token swap, Kyber Swap also offers things like non-custodial limit orders. They also have many features like price alert. They provide a seamless UI/UX for the end users to trade. And I think in a couple of weeks they will provide the fiat to crypto on RAM. This is gonna help onboarding the users much easier. Oh, of course, Kyber Swap is very mobile friendly. As in today you can already download the iOS or the Android mobile app. On all the app store. And this is the growth of Kyber Swap in the last few months. So in the last 6 months, we onboarded around 10,000 new users. And in terms of volume, we see 1.5x growth. A lot more people are downloading all the mobile apps, right? Another one that we want to give some spotlight to is SET protocol. So what they do is they allow people to, to manage their asset in different way. So the users, they can either buy a basket of token, right? Like, you know, be it DAI, Ether, or Bitcoin, or many other stablecoin. Or they can just follow some predetermined strategy, right, to manage their asset. And the way SET work with Kyber is that, like, when the users want to, for example, buy a basket of token, SET will do that on Kyber, right? The user only need to send Ether to the SET smart contract, and that smart contract will just talk to Kyber to buy all the asset that the users want to buy. And that makes it like very seamless for the users. They only need to send one single transaction, and they can buy and acquire all the asset that they want. So Kyber can only handle this volume for all the partners because we have a very big network of reserve, and we try to support more and more number of tokens. So we are also like one of the reserve in all these market makers that work with Kyber. Apart from that, we also connect to people like Oasis and Uniswap, and we have several professional market makers that work with Kyber as well. And if you want to be one of the market maker on Kyber, just go ahead and check out developer platform. We have a very detailed documentation on how to work with Kyber and how to be one of the liquidity providers. The top traded tokens, mainly stablecoins, especially DAI, thanks to all the integration with other DeFi applications. And a few other liquid tokens include like Maker, Omisego, or WBTC is a new thing that actually introduced a lot of volume as well. And Chainlink, Kyber, KNC token as well. Right, so what we have learned from the last, 6 or 7 months of growing, so one of the main challenges that we have been consistently facing is that, it's still very hard to onboard new users to our cryptocurrency or blockchain ecosystem, right? Like I think we spend a lot of time in hackathons and in events to introduce new users to start using dApp, but I think it's very hard for them to set up the wallet. It's very hard for them to acquire their first cryptocurrency, right? So we had to do a lot of like other strategy to onboard them, like giving out a preloaded wallet and just basically just give away Ether for them to start using Kyber. And that actually helps introduce some users to Kyber. But in general, it's still very hard, and I think we expect to see a lot more solution in the coming months to address these issues. And I think one reason that we, the key reason that we can build a large ecosystem of partners is that, it's very easy to integrate with Kyber. We have a very detailed documentation, and people can just basically read the documentation and integrate with Kyber. They barely have to talk to our developers, and that makes it very easy for them to work with Kyber. And one of the key reasons for the growth is the rise of DeFi as well. As I just mentioned earlier, 6 or 7 months ago, we didn't see any contribution from all the DeFi applications, right? But now they contribute almost like half of the volume to Kyber. And I think we expect to see the same growth in the coming months. So this basically summarizes all the growth and all the current starts of Kyber. So in the last 6 months, we handled around $156 million in terms of like trade volume, and every month I think the Kyber contract handles around 5,000 unique addresses. From various sources, right? Like be it wallets, be it other DeFi applications and things like that. We continue to increase the number of tokens that we can support and grow the ecosystem of integrated partners. And moving forwards, there are a few key long-term objectives that we want to achieve with Kyber. One of that is to keep driving the liquidity on the existing Kyber network on Ethereum. But we're also working on deploying the swap solution on different chain. We already started doing something with EOS, in which we build the trustless bridge between EOS and Ethereum, so that later on people can move the asset between the two chain in a trustless manner, right? We also support people to build Tomo swap. Basically, it's a Kyber deployment on Tomo chain. And together with many partners like BitGirl and Republic Protocol and many other projects, we together launched WBTC. It's a wrap Bitcoin initiative to bring Bitcoin liquidity to Ethereum, right? And WBTC is being adopted in many other DeFi application as well. Of course, focusing on the growth of the decentralized economy is one of our key focus as well. We want to focus, so there are five key areas that we want to focus. First of all, is end-user swap or end-user decentralized trading, right? Decentralized crypto payments, exchanges and trading, and decentralized finance, and providing liquidity for other trading platforms as well is one of our key focus. We have been doing a lot of experiments with decentralized governance, right? We do it with other like DAO Stack and many other DAO platform. So our long-term goal is that we want Kyber Network to be governed by a broader community, right? So I think it's going to take like a few years, 3 to 5 years, but I think it's a good time to start doing experiments and to see what's going to work and what's the key insight that we can get from all this experiment. Yep, with that, I want to conclude my presentation, and I truly believe that we need more liquidity to enable our decentralized economy. Yep. Oh, yeah, sorry, this is the last slide. We just launched the Kyber DeFi Hackathon with many other partners in the DeFi space like Chainlink, Melon, Compound, and B0X, and Synthetics. The total bounty is around 42,000 USD. I think it's one of the largest bounty that any DeFi hackathon has ever had. So yeah, feel free to go ahead to visit kyber.devpost.com and start building your first DeFi hackathon now and win a lot of bounty. Yeah, thanks.
Right. Testing. Right. Thank you, Mr. Loi, for sharing the stats about Kyber Network. So, as always, we'll be opening up the floor for any questions. But before that, I will ask one question just for clarification's sake. Can you just briefly describe or explain to the audience in layman terms what DeFi actually means? Because it's been used quite many times over the presentation.
I think it's DeFi is decentralized finance, right? It's yep. Like all the financial services that are offered in a decentralized manner, right? So let's talk about traditional finance, right?
Right.
In traditional finance, you always have you have to trust, you have to rely on some third party to provide the service for you, yeah. And you have to trust that person or that entity, right? But in DeFi, I think what's interesting is that you can still enjoy all these services, right? You can still do loan and margin trading and things like that without trusting on any single party, right?
Right.
And at any time, you can still, be the custody, have the custody of your own fund, right?
Okay, understood, thanks. So basically, lending without trust, spending your money on the internet without trusting any other parties, sort of. All right, thanks. Okay, so from the floor, any questions?
So I have a question about the performance when DeFi. So have you...
Can you move the mic closer?
Okay. So, can you do you have any performance testing with DeFi? First of all, how many transactions for the Kyber network? Because it is for the micropayment. Because it is for micropayment, so we need in the real world, so it's a lot of transactions will happen. So, how many transactions you can handle? in the network?
Can you repeat the question?
Just to clarify again, so you were asking about how many transactions Kyber can support, because you expect to see many micropayments happening there. Is that right?
I think, so currently Kyber runs entirely on Ethereum, right? So how many transactions we can handle really depends on how many transactions Ethereum can handle. And I guess in order to handle like micro payments and micro transaction, we probably need some solution micro payment channel, like Radar Network or Lightning Network is what we have in Bitcoin. And I think that's the best solution for micro payments. Yeah.
You mentioned Kyber Network is on Ethereum, is that? Yeah, so if you want to do the token swaps or things like that, so it has to be between Ethereum and ERC20 tokens, or it can be other tokens that are outside the Ethereum network?
Right, so currently we only support Ethereum and ERC20 tokens swap, right? Yeah. Because there are solutions to bring other asset to Ethereum, like the WBTC solution. So basically WBTC is the wrapped Bitcoin on Ethereum, and we also we are building other bridge like trustless bridge to allow people to move the asset from for example EOS to Ethereum, right? And so that you can still trade with other asset, right?
So is the your plan then to introduce more tokens, like for example the WBTC? Yeah, over time you are bringing more all these other tokens into the Ethereum network.
Yes, so we already support WBTC, and our plan is to try to bring more asset to Ethereum as well. That's why we have been working on all the bridge to connect Ethereum with other blockchain. Yeah.
All right. Yep. So for all our live audiences tuning in live from Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube, if you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comment sections. Our CoinGecko team will look at them and we will forward them to Mr. Loi for you. Right now, back to the floor. Any questions?
Hi, a very simple question. Who all are your key competitor?
Who are the competitors?
Yes.
To be honest, we don't really care about the competition at the moment. The market is too small. We are talking about like 10,000 daily active users in the space, right? So it doesn't make sense like to compete at the moment. But in terms of like who are providing similar platform or services, I guess any decentralized trading platforms, right? Like ZeroX, Uniswap, and all this platform. But as I mentioned earlier, Kyber has the ability to connect with all of them, right? And created one single liquidity pool that serve everyone else. Yeah.
So at present, there are so many similar service providers, like you say, one form or the other. What would it take for you guys to pool your resources together? Because it's already such a small market to serve, but if they can pool together, when would that happen?
I think it's already happening, right? Like Kyber already integrate with people like Oasis, Gnosis, Dashlane Auction, Uniswap, and I think even for ZeroX, they have been like working on initiative to take the liquidity from Kyber as well. So I think it's already happening, and it's just that it's not that obvious for the end users to see that. Yeah.
Hi, the founder of Ethereum has said that his network is running full. So is there any plans for Kyber to have your own mainnet?
That's an interesting question. I don't think there's a need for us to have a mainnet at the moment, like our own chain at the moment, right? Because I think currently most of the activities still happen on Ethereum. The ecosystem is still there, all the assets are still there. It doesn't make sense for us like to run to a new blockchain or like to build our own blockchain. Yeah. I think the main challenge that we want to address at the moment is the usability aspect, as in how to make it easy for the end users to onboard, right? To start using decentralized platforms. And I think, like, you know, in terms of like the network bottleneck, if we're talking about like, you know, paying $1 or $2 per transaction, right? And if your transaction value is like $1 or $2,000, I think it's okay, right? Like, you know, people have been paying like 1 or 2% to all the banks and financial institution. And here we are talking about like 0.1 or 0.2% of the transaction value. So it's fine.
Thank you.
Go ahead. I think we have a question from the...
Yeah, so there's a question from the live stream. Someone asks, from a business perspective, how is Kyber profiting from being the liquidity provider at the moment? And what are some monetization plans moving forward for the project? Yeah, thanks.
So in terms of like the team, we are still... Okay, so there are a couple of like... Let me put it this way, right? So we have a separate team that work on the protocol level, like just develop the smart contract, growing the ecosystem and things like that. So this team is still well funded by, you know, from the ICO money, right? And we have a team that work on like Kyber Swap that actually have revenue from all the trading fees, right? All the commission that we get from every transaction that happens on Kyber Swap. We also have a team that work on providing liquidity for the network itself. So this team is one of the liquidity contributor, right? And we actually like earn you know, nice and healthy revenue from the market making. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. Okay, just now you were talking about this DeFi. So my question is, from a traditional financial service institute point of view, how this DeFi is going to disrupt the traditional financial service like borrowing or lending? What pain points that this Kyber is actually trying to solve so that it can disrupt the traditional business?
I think so speaking of like disruption that device can create, right? I think first of all, it's very easy for anyone to use DeFi services, right? You only need an Ethereum address and that's it. You can just use whatever service that is available out there, instead of like, you know, comparing to the traditional finance, like, you know, even if, you know, company like Kyber, if you want to open a bank account, it's still very hard, right? Because, you know, for various reasons. And it's the same for, you know, like, you know, if any like any individual who want to use any you know, financial services out there, it's still very hard and it's a tedious process to go through all the you know, all the bank you know, requirements, right? And you know, in some country, if you are not lucky and you are born in countries like North Korea and undeveloped country, right, they are not even, you know, these services for you to use, right? So I think the nice thing about DeFi is that it's open, as in anyone can use, and it's permissionless. It's everywhere, right? Like, you know, you can use it. You only need the internet and an Ethereum address in order to use DeFi services. And I think for Kyber, our role in DeFi is that we want to be the transactional and the settlement layers, right? Like, if any DeFi application they have the need to liquidate their asset, their you know, collateral, or if they want to convert their asset in their portfolio, we can help them with that, and we do it in a permissionless and trustless model, right? So that we won't disrupt their trust model, right? Because the nice thing about DeFi is that you don't have to trust anyone. Now, if you want to liquidate your asset and you have to trust like another third party, that will, you know, ruin the entire things that they want to build, right? So for Kyber, we want to be that layer to help them to offer the best service to the end users.
All right, thank you very much. That was a great answer. And that's all the time we have for now, so we'll be moving on.
Thanks a lot. I'm going to be around.
Thank you very much to Mr. Loi, CEO and founder of Kyber Network.